morning, and I'm going to share information that was shared in the booklet, and I have had an opportunity to speak with Renelta, and so she's cool with, I think, with what I'm going to say. So we're good enough. All right.
Okay, here.
Renelta Arlouk is the director of the Indigenous Arts at the Banff Center of Arts and Creativity. Renelta of Inuvialuit, Dene, and Cree descent originates from the Northwest Territories. Raised by her grandparents on the trap line until school age, these teachings provided Renelta with the tools to become the actor, playwright, poet, director and producer she is now. She is committed to the development of Indigenous language-inspired stories. Renelta has worked in depth with Indigenous and minority youth on both sides of the border, which began in the North through her theater advocacy work as a producer and facilitator. Renelta's focus on decolonization pushes boundaries using art as a tool for reconciliation. Her work provokes new interactions across all lines while remaining true to her Indigenous roots. She is the first Indigenous woman to earn a Bachelor of Fine Arts acting degree from the University of Alberta and is an alumnus of the Center for Indigenous Theatre. Renelta is also the first Inuit to direct at the Stratford Festival. It's my pleasure to welcome and introduce Renelta.
Treaties, and I am grateful to be able to witness this beautiful land and water and meet you who reside here, Masicho and Kianik. Oh, I have a picture that goes up. Sorry, I reference it, so. sorry. Yeah, just one picture. I sent it to Felicity. And then I sent it on your email. Oh, shit. Okay, you're missing out. I thought it was something else.
I can put it.
It's on my phone.
Yes.
Okay, I'll go to you. I'm so sorry. Resonates with me. When we were growing up, all we wanted to do was go to places that took us away from where we've come from. We tend to believe that where we are now is never the place to remain. Where did we get this idea from? I used to think that my community was a place that people were stuck in. That the reason why they didn't leave was because they couldn't. And they didn't know how to. And the ones that left and returned, returned because they were failures in other places. I believed that my hometown did not define me. I got older and wiser, thankfully. As I traveled, I grew more experienced and met others from other places and came to realize, from these experiences that my hometown and community absolutely defined me. I still have flaws, of course, but because of that, I have flaws. It also has humor, and because of that, I have humor. We have these sayings and isms like, as if, wah, take it easy. It has its own fashion of trucker hats and snap-up shirts, polyester pants and fleece tops. It has scents of spruce trees and potted town flowers, sounds of rapids and ravens. It also has a view that permeated my young mind, permeates my now mind. Just one photo. Don't go any further. They shared them with me and are still being shared, thankfully. These practices and experiences then teach me how to act when I visit other communities, I meet with other people. I grew up a nomad. It still remains my way of living, but it doesn't mean I don't return to where places where my heart remains. I grew up with my grandparents on their nomadic travels, as prospectors and trappers when I was 2 until I had to go to school at the age of 5. Those years still hold the dearest part of who I am. Well, now it's joined by my son Carver and partner Talis, who have allowed me to be the best mother and partner I can be. I remember much light and vastness when I lived with my grandparents. I remember feeling the fullness of silence when watching my grandfather working away at sawing wood, building things, drinking tea. I remember my grandmother making stew, washing laundry, playing solitaire, and plucking her eyebrows. I played by myself, mostly, making up games where bears chased me, stars followed me, and giant hot dogs flew across the sky. True story. I truly believe this part of my life greatly influenced the artist I have become today. When people ask how I got to be here when I wasn't raised with the arts, I didn't take theater in high school. How could I? I was not raised in a place that taught it. I didn't take dance, piano, singing, none of it. I knew it existed. It wasn't like I didn't know others who didn't. It just was not accessible to me. A poor, young, Dene Inuit Cree girl being raised in the Northwest Territories along with a little brother, all done by a single mom. Odds were not in my favor to become an artist. Odds were more in my favor of being a statistic rather than a success. I wrote, though, real internal suffering kind of stuff, like poetry about love and alienation. I didn't play sports. That just wasn't my thing. That integral time of my life is far behind me. From there, it became about adjusting to new schools, new people, peers, city life, family hurts, material wants, and broken hearts. You know, life, the real stuff. So often in Indigenous teachings, we tend to speak from a place of experience. So that's why I'm using this part of my life to explain, to speak on how the arts unite and strengthen the voice of remote and isolated and rural communities. When we think about silence, the richness of silence, it becomes the sacred commodity that brings about feelings of unity, a time of when, of hope, of possibility, of connected to self, the way, the environment. It's so necessary, silence. However, when you think of it in the way of voice, it has this opposite effect to it. When we feel like we cannot be heard or felt or appreciated, we begin to feel silenced. The action of adding an ED greatly impacts its meaning. And this is where the arts greatly impacted me and therefore my becoming an artist. Being raised in the bush offered so much silence around me that I was able to fill my imagination with great stories, big visions, and so much color. I had no limits but my own, as a child in the bush with two caring grandparents who were not helicopter by any means, I did not know limits except bedtime. What created the silencing was when I left them to go to school. I don't want to say that education is not important. It is vital. What I do want to say is that freedom of creativity is what allows the freedom to be felt when the daily practice of existing takes over. You know, life, the real stuff. I was a quiet child, introvert, still am in many capabilities, but I also had to become an extrovert to make friends. Because as a child, I moved around a lot. From one place to the next, sometimes towns, sometimes cities. I needed to reach out in comparison to the ones who grew up together since kindergarten and did not have to grow their circle of friends. Most of my life then was often around people who did not look like me, eat food that I liked, and often had more things than I had. The silencing by society. This really messed me up as a kid, but when I spent summers with my grandparents back up north, that's when I found balance again, and I felt heard again. This cycle of silencing is detrimental to growth as children and as growing adults. This is where the arts and community play a factor, a greater factor. Art is another word for voice or identity. The expression through art allows the expression of voice. The silence become heard by way of audience or witness. When I began my career as a theater artist, it wasn't until I was 19. Again, how was I to know what I was to become? I had this experience where I traveled through the United States with an Apache environmental activist. He needed someone to be his administrator, and I was in need of a job, but more likely adventure, so I did it. I traveled with him and his daughter and other cohorts to places like the Pueblo in Taos, New Mexico, pitching stories to producers in Los Angeles, attending Sundances in South Dakota, hearing John Trudell speak at the base of a mined mountain in Montana, partaking in sweat lodge ceremonies in Yosemite National Park, where young indigenous people talked about change. I call this my stepping off the mountain journey. As someone who has lived and breathed culture, I was given the opportunity to see other indigenous cultures firsthand and witness how it can be stripped away, celebrated, survived, regained. When I went back to my home community, I looked at what I could offer to keep my culture thriving. Now, I live and work with one purpose, to keep my culture alive. Not on a shelf to be studied, but to be brought to life, to be heard on stage, radio, text, poetry, in different voices, multiple languages, so that we are never silenced. The need of artists' voice applies to our communities. We need its voice heard even among people who appear to be saying the same thing. Art is a reflection that not only allows us to grow our own work, but also to broaden that of our community. Art asks for diversity in perspective, in culture, in mediums, in story. The whole premise of art is to create conflict. It's beautiful and challenging. The conflict and discussion art creates allows us to move forward and change for the better to build a stronger community so that we can become. We search out silence. Even as I wrote this keynote address, I sat with my hotel desk facing the window so this could be my view as I wrote. I moved that picture. I am not saying we only need silence to create. That's not true. What is true is that we need to feel heard. Perhaps that's why bigger centers have greater art presence, because they are simply more people there to hear our voice. So we connect to silence, then leave to search for where our voice can be heard and have audience so we aren't silenced. Seems simple enough. Also, it's a bit self-serving. Thankfully, it's more than that. I have heard on more than one occasion, even if this artwork makes a difference for one person, I feel I have accomplished what I set out to do. So adding that to be heard requires someone to witness it and then also feel heard. That is what builds community. Communities hold stories and therefore voice. This amazes me. It is the isolation and remoteness that allow culture and language to grow. If we look at the recent discovery of Sir John Franklin's HMS Erebus in 2014 and HMS Terror in 2016, the knowledge of where these two ships ended up were always known by Inuit of the area, and that knowledge was passed down from generation to generation since 1847. If it wasn't for Inuit knowledge, I want to meet this guy, Mike, the ships would not have been found where and when they were. Though this information was not new, Charles Francis Hall, an explorer that had spent considerable time in the Arctic and learned moderate inuktitut, was given that information by Inuit in the late 1880s. He had written about it during his first expedition, but it was not until technology and community knowledge united that the rest of Canada was able to witness what the Inuit community had always known. It is both land and people together that keep our history alive. There is this powerful movement that is growing. It allows remote and isolated rural communities to access each other nationally and globally without compromising way of life and become heard on a greater scale. It allows our artists that were displaced and left their community to become successful at home and not have to make the choice to leave anymore. That movement is social media. The question we used to ask was, Why are the arts so hard to access in remote, isolated communities? It was due to lack of immediate access to what was happening in the larger centers, like Toronto, Montreal, New York City, Vancouver, the list goes on. And because of that, we were taught arts were unattainable. Now, with social media like YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, Instagram, fashion and jewelry makers are selling their creations worldwide with barely a website, likely a Facebook page or Instagram account. These same artists are being invited to take part in Indigenous Fashion Week in Toronto, with fairs, accommodations paid, and honorariums offered. Graphic designers are able to create designs on their computer at home and send it electronically to companies who will make and distribute their art with no more than a click and be paid for it via e-transfer. Youth are teaching themselves how to play cello or dance using YouTube instructional videos. When we look at how minds are being changed about Inuit seal hunting through the informative documentary work Alethea Arnatcook-Barrell offers from the Inuit perspective on angry Inuk, we then begin to hear a voice without compromising connection to community. It becomes less about population and more about what makes us human. Of course, this isn't perfect. Theater is still greatly underrepresented in communities. Art spaces are passed over for sports arenas. People would rather turn on the TV than attend a musical event. There is still much work we have to do within our communities to foster and grow our artists and make space for them. Perhaps it's because they're called remote and isolated rural communities. Maybe if we call them destinations for thought and creativity. I kid, but Banff has always been a gathering place for Blackfoot, Stoney Nakoda, Tsitsina, Dene that reside there, and it's beautiful. And as director of Indigenous Arts, I get to ask Indigenous artists of all capacities to come, dream, build, promote, and create there. And I get to offer them a place to use their voice. I get to support them as teachers and as students, and most importantly, as artists. If there's anything I can offer you from this talk, is to find ways to offer space for the creative voice in your community. We are no longer bound by distance by the way that we used to be. We are no longer limited to the audience of few. Most importantly, we are no longer held to only the teachings around us. We are at a time where all the worlds are accessible to us no matter where we live. This is huge. We no longer have to choose where we do art and where art is seen. There are many ways to activate community and have it be more than a place one visits family. As wonderful as that is, it can also be a place where artists come to create new work and show new work. Like the view I had here for the past few days, I've only written this keynote address. I've not only written this keynote address, I also wrote a draft of a new play I was commissioned for. Artists are revitalizers of community. Faroe Yukon used to be a mining town. When the mine closed, housing costs went down and artists bought them up. Now Faroe is an artist community full of wonderful older artists who will bring you a cake with your name on it when you come to tell them stories at their library. True story. We are no longer limited by our community, by what our community cannot provide because it's not a mainstream destination. The cycle of silencing can be stopped with grant support, social media promotion, recommendations, or even becoming one yourself. Do it. We can all become the places where people gather and support and create deep felt changes from grassroots level. As a theater artist, my family still does not know what I really do. I tell them I write plays and act in other plays and direct some plays. And they say, uh-huh, good for you, my girl. They don't know Stratford or CBCQ or BAM Center. But my grandma saw me at APTM the other week on Dene and Journey, and she called to tell me I did good on cutting up that beluga. I enjoy telling stories for live audience. audience, but sometimes reruns help for, you know, life, not the real stuff. So, Masi Cho, Kianik, for allowing me to share this space with you this morning. I look forward to getting to know you during our time here, and I'm grateful.
I'm 6'2". So you're 5'1"?
Yeah.
That's hilarious. The long and the short of it. My name is Michael Kippert, and I'm a member of the Spark Network Steering Committee. And my job is to thank Renata for her talk today. I have a whole page of notes that I want to talk about, but we don't have time for that. A couple of things that stood out for me. First of all, thank you for your sense of humor, and to your grandparents and your parents for your sense of humor. If I had a technological glitch like you had, I would have been in a puddle on the floor. Anyway, so many things resonated with me about community and what your community does for you as a child. We are all shaped by our community, whether we want to believe it or not. I grew up in a very small town in southern Ontario, and I go back there and I think, this is not the place where I grew up, because it sure doesn't look the same. It's now swallowed up by Mississauga. But I go back there and, oh yes, that's my home. Your references to silence, I was intrigued by that as well. I also, and your view, if I could get my picture up there, I have a fantastic view out of my dining room window, and that's where I sit when I want to write something, and it's silent, and it's wonderful. I live in the Halliburton Highlands, and I'm sure that all resonates with many of you as well. Another phrase that intrigued me was, we are not limited by what our community cannot provide. In this age of social media, oh man, it just boggles my mind sometimes when I think about that. And I think back 20 years ago, when none of this existed, how did we function? I don't know. We did, but now we have access to literally the world, and you have shown us how we can. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. 5'1", 6'2".
Things going, I guess.
Unless you have anything to
add. Perfect. Okay.
I will make it all go to the left.
No, it's about perfect height for me, actually. I guess I'm right in the middle of it. So, before I get on to some other announcements, I just want to take a second to thank Drew and Peter over here. I don't know where Peter is at this exact moment in time. Probably at one of our venues setting up. But just if we can give a round of applause to our technicians. I don't know if everyone here is aware that we have been, are we live streaming right now?
We are.
Great, we're live streaming. Kind of thought maybe that would have stopped after the keto, but that's fine. That we've been live streaming the keynote addresses and some other things to our public page, and lots of people have been tuning in there who have not been able to make it here, and that's wonderful to be able to share some elements with the broader Spark community, so that's awesome. There were a few things found yesterday. If you are missing, Shondell's gonna